here, so I'm glad you guys have come out. Wanted to present all the information about Gypsy Moth to you guys. I'm sure most of you got the letter or maybe saw the articles in the local news about the proposed Gypsy Moth treatments we're talking about for the area. So I'm Chris Elder. I'm the program manager here for North Carolina Department of Agriculture and Consumer Services Gypsy Moth program. I wrote about tonight what we're going to be talking about. This is our general outline. We're going to talk about the five W's of Gypsy Moth. Who we are, who deals with Gypsy Moth in North Carolina, what Gypsy Moth is, when we might be treating and trapping, where we're talking about doing this treatment, why we're treating for Gypsy Moth. And I've also added how. How do you treat Gypsy Moth? How do you deal with the Gypsy Moth infestation? First, who? These are little slogans that show different groups that are involved with Gypsy Moth in North Carolina. You got the U.S. Forest Service is involved cooperatively with us at the North Carolina Department of Agriculture. We joined into a group called the Slow the Spread Foundation, which is all the 10 states that are along the leading edge of the infestation joined together to share information and tactics and technologies. We'll talk about that a little bit more in just a moment. And also the North Carolina Forest Service cooperates with us. Again, this is who we are, who I am. Is there anybody else here from a government agency? First, I'd like to introduce, I do know some people here from government agency. This is Ginger Hemmings. She works in Surrey County. She's a plant pest specialist in the area that does a lot of inspections and trapping over there. And I have Chad Taylor. He works in Allegheny County and several other counties. Both of these folks cover several counties apiece. You work out of Watauga County, but over here in Allegheny, does the same type of thing. He's a plant pest specialist.
Aaron Ray Tompkins, extension agent here in the county.
And Allegheny. Very good. Glad you're here. Anybody else? Okay. Very importantly, you guys are all here. There's a bunch of you. I'm glad you're all here, and we'll have a time at the end of the session when I'll take all your questions and comments. I'd be glad to field any of that. If you just remember these questions till the end, we can go back over anything that I flew over. I tend to talk a little fast. I've got a lot of information to share. So just hold your questions at the end if you could, please. This many people, it gets kind of chaotic if people try to interrupt with a question in the middle. And I'll be glad to go back over anything you didn't get. So has anybody here ever experienced an infestation of Gypsy Moth? A couple here and there. Yeah. Well, if you have any stories to tell, I'd be glad to hear about them at the end, but it can be pretty bad. A lot of the pictures I use in this presentation are from North Carolina. This is a live oak tree down on Hatteras Island that we found an infestation at this summer. And this is a picture taken at the end of May when this tree, being live oak, should be full of leaves and it's all been stripped down bare. It's a very bad problem when you get this, and we'll talk more about that. So what is Gypsy Moth? We'll do the basic biology of Gypsy Moth. The problem with Gypsy Moth is this caterpillar right here. It looks kind of like a tent caterpillar. If you ever seen tent caterpillars in the springtime, they make a web in cherry trees usually. They're kind of furry, striped, and black. It looks a lot like this. This is a different creature. These are solitary caterpillars. They don't make a web, so they won't be on the end of the branch, won't be in the crotch of the tree. They just crawl around by themselves and hide during the day a lot of times. They have a row of double red dots and then double blue dots down their back. This distinguishes them from other caterpillars. Over in this picture, you can see different life stages. Both of these pictures were taken at Hatteras. We had all this summer. All in one picture here, these are two adult male gypsy moths here who are attempting to mate a female gypsy moth. They are distinguished by their antenna. You see these heavy antenna if you're close enough to see that. Also up here at the edge, you see the back end of a female gypsy moth. She's laying egg mass right there. She's sitting on it. And then these are two old egg masses that were that hatched in the previous spring. And then you see there's a bunch of webbing all through here. And there's a pupal case right here, a cocoon, one right here. And there's some old dead caterpillars and stuff in here too. There's a pupal case right there. So you have just about all the life stages right there in one little picture. The females are flightless when they come out. Both of these adult male and female come out at the same time. The female will come out of a cocoon and start putting out a scent that attracts the males to her. They mate her, she lays eggs, right in the same spot. She just came out right here. Both of these females came out right in this area and attracted these males. The males are flying around trying to pick up the scent. And that's very important that this scent, this pheromone, it's called pheromone, the scent they put out. We utilize that in trapping and treatment. There is one life stage per year of gypsy moth. 3/4 of the year spent as an egg. This is a picture of an egg mass. They're kind of felty looking and kind of rust colored when they're fresh. They hatch in the spring. This is probably a little early for this area. Down in the flatland, down at the coast in the Piedmont area, they'll hatch 1st April. Up here, probably a few weeks later than that. So they hatch, they feed for about 6 weeks. The caterpillars have different stages. They molt and molt and molt and get bigger and bigger and bigger. They end up about the size of a pinky or so when they're at the end. There's 5 or 6 different stages of caterpillars. Then they pupate for about 2 or 3 weeks. They'll be pupae. They make these little cocoons. They stick them up on the trees where they happen to be. And then they emerge as the adults for a period of 2 to 4 weeks to mate. They lay the eggs. The moths die. The moths don't do any significant damage. It's the caterpillars that are the problem. Gypsy moth is an invasive species. It's not native to North America, and this is the biggest problem with them. Back in 1869, this gentleman here, Mr. Trullo, decided he wanted to create a better silkworm. So he brought over some gypsy moth from Europe and Asia, where they're native, and mated them with the silkworms. It didn't really make a better silkworm, but then his gypsy moth escaped, one way or another. This is in Medford, Massachusetts, 1869. So ever since then, they got established there in Massachusetts and been spreading. They spread fairly slowly at first. They got built up, and then they've been spreading fairly rapidly since then. This is a graphic that goes through the years of the quarantine as it spread. This is a federally quarantined pest. It goes up to 2007. You can see just kind of the way the fire is burning here from Massachusetts out. Another way of looking at it, with a static image, these are chunks of time that equate to sometimes 5 or 10 years, sometimes 25. They just grayed out, as you can see. This green here is 1985 to 1994. These are all the counties that were added in that time period. So you can see it really spread very rapidly across Virginia in that time period, in those 9 or 10 years. And in the very corner of North Carolina, in Currituck County, a little piece of Dare County, right down to Kitty Hawk, is also quarantined in 1988 because we had such a high population there. Since then, there's been no additions in North Carolina to the quarantine. But other areas, you see Virginia over here from 1995 to 1999, in a 5-year period, they added these several counties here, about 8 or 9 counties that they added right along the leading edge. But they still, we trap very heavily right along the Virginia line, and they haven't yet spread into North Carolina in such numbers that we would consider it to be infested and in quarantine. Here lately, 2005 to 2014, the last 10-year period, they're spreading down the Appalachian chain. That's almost like an arrow's point right down the Appalachian chain. You can see it's a little thinner in these other areas, but it's really gone through West Virginia and Virginia in a hurry. These states are all doing work trying to suppress gypsy moth where they have it. And all these states, I talked about the Slow to Spread Foundation, these states are on the leading edge of this quarantine here, work together. They're part of the Slow to Spread Foundation. So we all do our own trapping and treatment here that's all coordinated in an attempt to slow this down. Why is gypsy moth spreading so fast? Well, each of these little egg masses, you can see them all over this tree, have 300 to 1,000 egg masses. These females can lay several egg masses. These are all females. This is about, I counted about 40 females on this one tree. This is down at Hatteras Island again. So this tree is just eating up with these things. So each one of these little egg masses you see on here is probably 150 to 100 on there. They're all gonna hatch that many more caterpillars the next year. So you get exponential growth when they start getting into these numbers, when the numbers build up where they can find each other and reproduce quickly. When the caterpillars are big, the full size, the last instar, the last stage of a caterpillar can eat up to 1 square foot a day of leaf material. And it's hard to see in this picture. It kind of shows up dark projection, but these are little groups of caterpillars. Right at the end of the life stage, they've been eating on this tree. You can see a lot of bare branches. They kind of band together. You might remember the picture where I had all the different life stages on there. When they're ready to pupate, they kind of band together and then web across. And they're all kind of protected together. That's the only time that they aggregate like that. They eat a lot of different trees, but they focus primarily on oak trees. They like white oaks especially, but they'll eat just about any oaks. They eat the live oaks, we found out very happily. This is again right along Highway 12 in Buxton. You can pick out the oak trees by the defoliation that was present this summer. Fortunately, in this situation, these trees leaf back out. They can sustain 2 or 3 years of this kind of foliation before it starts killing the trees. And every time they do that, it weakens the tree, because the tree is used to putting out one flush of leaves and has to put out a second one that's using that energy up. And it's not getting any photosynthesis because there's no leaves. Like I said, they'll eat 300 different species of trees. And so if they start starving off of the oak trees, they'll move on to other stuff and eat that too, just because they have to. They won't thrive on other things. They have a preferred host list, and there's kind of a moderate host list and other things they'll eat. But they'll eat grass, they'll eat anything just to survive through to the next life stage. Because they did not evolve in North America, there are no natural enemies here. Not the ones that would control the population. Some things like white-footed mice or chipmunks or blue jays have been known to eat some gypsy moth caterpillars, or especially the pupae of cocoons. But obviously they have them up in the northeast of Massachusetts, and they were not enough to control the population. There's just so many caterpillars out that even if they're eating all this stuff, they're never going to catch up with them. The growth explodes. There's another picture from Hatteras. These are wax myrtles. They'll eat on those, but they're not a preferred host. So you can see a little feeding in there when we were down there, but these are all the live oaks right behind them. There are natural enemies in Europe and Asia where the gypsy moth is native. There's a virus in particular, and also another a fungus that attacks gypsy moth is present there, and we do use these as means of control here, but it's not established enough to hold the population down to where it's not causing this kind of damage. So why do we treat gypsy moth? I think you've gotten some hints about this. Primarily, they can alter the ecology. This is not North Carolina. This is somewhere, I think, in Pennsylvania. Given the topography, it's very similar to here in a lot of ways. You can identify the oaks and the susceptible species by the defoliation here. When they eat this, they get in such great numbers, they eat all the trees up like that, then you can imagine these trees are all gonna die off. There's a whole different species gonna come up underneath there, things that can that will tolerate gypsy moth feeding will grow up under there, so the whole ecology will just shift over to different species. And then down in creek bottoms, where these trees are eaten out, the sun comes in and heats the streams and can kill off the trout and anything else, any crustaceans that are in those streams. If it gets too warm in there, it'll kill them off. So it just completely alters the environment when it comes through like this and causes widespread death of trees. Also, that's what I call aesthetic issues. So this is where we found the gypsy moth in Buxton area. This guy's house, he called and said, I had an infestation of gypsy moth that was so bad I had to get a pest control company here to spray him. So he sprayed all these trees. And yet when we got out of the truck and we're walking around in the yard, you could literally hear the droppings falling out of the trees where the caterpillars that were still surviving were defecating. And so if he had all the caterpillars were still alive, you can imagine how much droppings, all those leaves are just been processing the droppings and dropping off. And if you had big tall white oak trees and all the caterpillars would be in there doing that, primarily all the droppings are getting on everything, on your picnic table, on your patio, on your car, everywhere you look. And then there's the caterpillars. These caterpillars are falling out of the tree, or they're crawling around looking for some place to hide, and they're all over everywhere. They get in the house. I've had stories of people saying that they just had to move out of the house while the caterpillars were crawling, because they were coming in the house and getting into the cupboards and getting into the food and everything, just looking for places to hide. So those little hairy caterpillars are just everywhere. And speaking of hairy caterpillars, this is one from down there in Buxton, and if you can look closely, the people in front can probably see there's just a couple of hairs loose on my hand there, and all these hairs are sticking out on this thing. They are not stinging caterpillars, but these hairs do contain a small amount of venom. And so when I was holding that, I balled my hand around it, and where the hairs were getting into the softer parts of my hand, I could actually feel it tingling. It was kind of burning out. It was like electricity getting my hand. Well, these hairs break off and fly in the air also. And so if you're allergic to the hairs at all, if you're just breathing these in, they're going to cause you respiratory problems. They can cause asthma. There are hundreds of thousands of caterpillars shedding hairs like this, and you can have a lot of issues. These hairs are also a pretty good defense against natural enemies. Nobody wants to eat these things because of this. There were two big tom turkeys loose when I was down there. And there were somebody's pets. They were just walking around, and they'd follow us around some. So I took that caterpillar in my hand and held it out there for them to eat. And they looked at it and wouldn't eat it. I plucked off a pupa. from the tree and held it out there, and they snapped it right up. So those hairs are very much a deterrent against feeding on those things. We're also interested in treating these infestations because they are easily spread artificially. This is the underside of a vehicle, obviously. These are egg masses. These females, when they pupate, and they go someplace to hide, and they wet themselves up as a pupa, and they sit there. When they come back out, wherever the female is, she just crawls right out of the case and immediately starts trying to attract the males. And if she happens to be on the side of the house, or on a grill, on a camper, or a boat especially, they do that frequently. They lay those egg masses, and then people unwittingly will move this item, what we call outdoor household articles and that kind of stuff. They'll move this, and then wherever they go, this egg mass is with them, and in the spring, that egg mass will hatch wherever it is, and you can get population started that way. Very common. Not as common as it could be, but it's very common. Again, this is a map of the quarantine. I wanted to talk about that briefly. This, as I mentioned before, this is a federally quarantined insect. And so the U.S. government regulates the movement of certain articles, what they call regulated articles. These would include logs, nursery plants, and outdoor household articles like grills and boats and campers and such. Also, firewood. Firewood I should put on there because that's probably the easiest way to move people, or move gypsy moth. People will, throw a little firewood in the back of the camper when they come down somewhere to camp. They burn some of it. If they don't, they leave it out for somebody else. Well, and that firewood could very easily just have egg masses on it. They don't really realize that. They're going to hatch out and get started. And it's true of several pests. Several pests are spread that way. Emerald ash borer is very easily spread that way because you don't know it's in there. All you see is little holes. And you don't realize it's in there. Gypsy moths, you can at least see the egg masses. And you might have a chance of scraping that off. Very important not to carry firewood away from areas with you. There's a big push of information to tell people to buy their firewood locally and burn it locally. You don't want to carry firewood and burn it for any long distances. Another reason why we treat it is because we have effective tools. This pheromone I mentioned has been isolated for many years now and used for trapping and treatment. So there's been many, many decades. Gypsy moth has been treated. Even from back in the early days in the late 1800s, when they first got it out, they attempted different ways of controlling that. And these tools have evolved over the years and are pretty highly refined. The treatments that we do provide protection for landowners directly and indirectly. And there's a study that showed for every dollar we spend in a gypsy moth program, it benefits the general public $3. So, I mean, it makes sense to do this. More numbers, I won't read this off to you at all. You can pick out different stuff. It talks about forestry and such. Christmas trees, I will point this out. It's a big impact on Christmas trees. They can feed on the Christmas trees. Not such a big issue. It's probably not a primary host. But they're going to lay the egg masses on the Christmas trees. And then nobody's going to want our Christmas trees unless they've been inspected or treated somehow. And so inspectors like Ginger or Chad will come out and inspect those. Charge your feet in some cases to move these trees. And so we need to keep this out of Christmas tree production areas as much as possible. Same thing for nurseries. There's a lot of nurseries up here. Similarly, these egg masses will get laid on these trees and you can't ship them with egg masses on them because it's a federal quarantine. Also, personally for landowners and for a homeowner, if you get your big white oak in front of your house, gets defoliated enough time, it's already under stress a little bit, a tree will die and you gotta remove it. How do you put a value on a big shade tree that's over your house? You can't. So how do we do this? I'll mention again the Slow the Spread Foundation, where different groups work together. All these great states here are part of the front edge here, are part of the Slow the Spread Foundation. Scientific research shows that if nothing was done about gypsy moths, it's spreading about this quickly every 10 years. But with the tools that we use, it's calculated that this is the rate of spread. So we're going from way down here in 2045 to right here in 2045. So this slow spread program has been in place basically since I started in 1990, trying out about 2000 in the fall, and it's been very effective. Some of the early calculations when they first started with about 2025 would be to here. well, that's about the truth, and then beyond through. So actually for 2015, they said it would be about